So I would like to introduce the next speaker, Professor Norbert A. Campo from University of Basel, and he will deliver a series of lectures in this school on Riemann surface and introduction. So I request Professor A. Campo to please start your lecture.
Thank you very much for invitation to expand here about Riemann surfaces. And so I'm very happy to see, I see all ages. So it's for me kind of this very important for me to see also younger persons. So most of you are all younger as me. I think all, but so it is about surfaces. So what we need is to first construct one surface. So let's construct one surface. So I start with the ring of polynomials in one unknown. So these are polynomials in one unknown. And what you can do in this ring, you have operations, so you can add them and you can multiply them. But there's something missing. Division is missing. So division. At school, we put division like this, but division is missing. I do not have a good short thing for division. So division is missing. You do not have. So if something is missing, what you want to do is to add this by brute force. So in what we look for maps to something which is called a field. So I take the set of all those maps to fields. But I only are interested in which part we hit. So I take surjective maps to fields. And this is a set. So can somebody draw this set as a surface? So this is a set, the set of all those guys is a set. And if you have a set, I think it is a good strategy if you draw this set, then you see something. So, question, can somebody draw this set? So this set, everybody knows this set. It has many names, and I think it is just the Riemann sphere. The Riemann sphere. So first, let's expand on this, which kind of fields can appear here. So the field of real numbers can appear here. Then the field of complex numbers can also appear here. And there is some field which is forbidden in universities at low level. But if you are famous, you are allowed to talk about that field. So it is the field with one element. Field with one element. So this field was introduced by Tietz, and it took a long time that this was considered as something useless, but then it gained an importance, and then you can take the moduli space of this field, so you take all deformations of this field, which is this forbidden field, and the space of deformations is a model for what is called quantum topology nowadays. So this field is really in the center of the world. But we do not talk about it. So if you hit this field, you can ask in how many different ways you can hit the field of real numbers. So how many maps have as extra property that The target field is the field of real numbers. That's a subset. Let's call R index R. That's a subset such that the target, the image, is the field of real numbers. Then we can look at the subset such that the image is the field of complex numbers. And then we have this subset such that the image is the field of one element. So let's start from this. So if you have a map to a set with one element, then to construct this at one element. So the zero map does this. It's the zero map. So here is easy. This one point is the zero map. But this is far away from imagination. Therefore, I take this notation. I call it infinity. Infinity is something which is far away from imagination. This is the field with one element. So let's now talk about this. So there is one map. It's easy. Sending x to 0. Then from every polynomial remains only the constant term. And if you multiply polynomials, constant terms add and multiply, so this is a ring morphism. I wish to have ring maps, so ring morphism, not just any map. I forgot to say this perhaps. So the only thing which I need to that every ideal is spent by one element. So it is what's the name? Principle. Is spent by one element. So if I take this polynomial, that this polynomial will spend an ideal, and then usually round brackets around that polynomial says which ideal you have. And here I let A vary, this small a varies over all real numbers. Then I get many maps. And the field is, the quotient field is the field of real numbers, and these are all possibilities of having such a map. So if I wish to have those guys here, then we know how to do this. If I send x to I, then I have an example. But there are many ways of doing this. So I again have an ideal, and then I can insist that I write the generator as the generator with leading coefficient 1. So the leading coefficient of the polynomial generating the ideal is x squared, and then you have other coefficients. And here we must be careful. This polynomial, this is the field. So the polynomial, the ideal generated should be a prime ideal. So prime ideal means this polynomial does not split as with real factors. And then in high school we learned something about this. This happens if the discriminant is negative, and then it does not split. And I forgot to write the letter A here, but at school I learned that the discriminant is b squared minus 4ac. That's what we learned at school. But a was 1. So the condition is this should be negative.
then the polynomial does not split. And that means the image is a field, and this a copy is a field of complex numbers. So now we can almost draw this set. Perhaps I could here this I can rewrite as b square is bigger than 4c. And solving this.
Other way.
I do not want, but this destroys my story. was I right with high school? B square minus 4ac is discriminant. Eh?
Yeah.
Right. that should be negative, yeah. B square. So I wrote this. I know I'm very happy. This is positive. Hmm? Yeah. And so this set of all B, C real numbers with this property. This we can draw. Huh? That's a parabola and it's above the parabola. Huh? And there are different drawings. So you can draw it like this. Here is some X is above a parabola. So this is the set. And then there are people who transform this. They say we put the parabola flat. Then they say this is the set, the upper half plane. And then there are people who bend this upper half plane in some way and draw something like this. They say this is the disk. So this set is a disk. But I'm slightly wrong. This B plus B and minus B is the same. So these are two disks. This set is one disk and another disk. This or those where B is positive, and this or those where B is negative. And then the whole thing is glue those two disks. The whole set is just this. One disk and lower half is the other disk. So this set is the sphere. And then this would be the real line. And say we put the point infinity here. So now we have a picture of this set. So the construction has some symmetries. So all the symmetries of this set, the group of symmetries of this object, of this ring, the group of symmetries acts on this construction. So the symmetries on polynomials. We replace x by x minus t. This is called translation. We translate. And then we can replace x by, we multiply by some number. And that are the symmetries. And so those symmetries act on the whole business here. There's one symmetry which acts also on this story, but not on the whole story. When I look on this part here, I can do another symmetry. So the polynomial does not split. That means C is non-zero. Because if not, it would split by X. X is a factor. So C is non-zero. So that means I can make out of this another such polynomial. The polynomial 1 over C squared plus B over CX plus x squared is another such symmetry. Let's do this symmetry for a very famous polynomial. when I do x square plus 1, or plus 1, the roots of this polynomial are I and minus I. And when I do this operation on this polynomial, I find back this polynomial. So this is the symmetry of the story. Perhaps in this picture, we must try to figure out where is I. Let's put plus I here. Then minus I would be here. And this symmetry is the symmetry of, now I can say the upper thing will be hyperbolic plane. And this is symmetry which fixes the point I. But we have some symmetries. So we have the symmetries coming from the automorphisms of this, and then we have some extra symmetry which is artificial, which is introduced here. And if I put those two symmetries together and I use matrix notation, those transformations I can write them as this. And then what I did there, I can write this as the matrix one minus one zero zero. And then I can look at the group spent by those two, this collection of matrices of this type and this, and this is PSL2R. So the construction has naturally the symmetries which are heading directly their hyperbolic geometry. So let's see on more elementary level. So the AC, which I described here as ideals of some special type, spent by some special polynomial. This AC, I can also draw it like follows. I draw upper half plane, and an element of AC is a polynomial which has only complex roots. Yeah?
The first matrix you have written. Lambda is 0, 1, but the
parameter is not. I was all my student time I was bad with matrices, so you should correct yourself.
Okay. The
term
is not what
I'm. This was just a warning, so it could be very well that's wrong.
I would say lambda t 0, 1 by lambda.
Okay. Lambda t.
Lambda is going to zero, right?
The first entry. Lambda, it's non-zero.
Okay, so, but is actually a value. So, the last entry should be 1 by lambda.
You are right. Yeah. But the mistake is, of course, we do very bad linear algebra. This, if you wish to describe this, you need 3 by 3 matrices.
Okay.
There's no 2 by 2 matrix representation of this. Of course, there's a 2 by 2 matrix representation of this, where you write A, B, C, D, and then you do something, you say, I write this, but what I write is not important, it's up to sign. If it is forbidden to write things up to sign, you need 3 by 3 matrices. So here, you should think the right 3 by 3 matrix. And now, and here is the translation. And here, I do not know how to transform this. But the mistake is coming from there. But I do not like matrices. Here is this. So, an idea which does not split has two roots. One in the upper half plane and one in the lower half plane. So, the set AC is just the same as the set of the upper half plane. And upper half plane, I prefer this notation. The upper half plane. H is too hyperbolic. So, in this set, written in this way, we have lines. So when I have two polynomials, which are positive functions on the real line, I have two of them. Then I can make convex combination of them. So this, if x is a real variable, this is always positive. This is always positive. So when I take t to be positive, then this whole thing stays positive. And when at the same time I take 1 minus t to be positive, this whole thing stays positive. So here, t is confined to be in 0, 1. So, this gives me a family of degree 2 polynomials which do not split. So this gives me a path in C+. So let's think that the root of this polynomial was the point P, the root in upper half plane, and that the root in the, from the other polynomial was the point Q. So this family of polynomials gives me the family of points in upper half plane. So I have some curve connecting those two points. So interesting question is, which is this curve? And then we go back to high school, and then we see that this curve is the semicircle with center at the real line going through P and Q. So in this model, we have immediately a system of interesting lines, which become later if we introduce matter and Fourier test. So precisely, if you take the mid point of the Euclidean connection, Euclidean line, and then the mid perpendicular, this hits somewhere, and that is the center of this line. And this is just a little computation. You have to know Pythagoras theorem, but not more. And Pythagoras theorem is on the floor outside. So we have all those lines, but no, interesting question is, can we find in this picture the metric? Is somewhere hidden the metric? Yeah, the metric is also hidden. So here I draw this D line. We have already one point, interesting, it's the point 0. Then we have the point 1. The point 0 corresponds to Q. The point 1 corresponds to P. And of course, this expression stays positive also when t is slightly below 0, but not too far. But if I exaggerate, at some moment, the polynomial splits. This is something negative, but as long if t is negative, then this whole thing is negative. But as long as it's smaller as this guy, then it stays positive, it's okay. At some moment, it goes wrong. Let's go give this a name, t minus pq. And then the other side, symmetrically happens when you run out here, then this becomes negative, this is positive, it stays positive a long time, but at some moment, called t plus pq, it becomes negative. So this construction gives me for free four lines, four points on the real line. So out of those 4 points, I can cook up many things. So what you can do is you can take the cross ratio of those 4 points. So cross ratio is you multiply the long pieces, you multiply those. So that means 1 minus this guy times this one minus 0, and you divide by the short ones. Then you get a number, and this is a positive number. And then you can put log in front of this thing. And then perhaps I forgot something, but this is the hyperbolic method. The something is, perhaps somewhere I have to put a half, I think here. But this is this question mark. I have to check. But this is the hyperbolic method. So, and also from this construction, you can see a Riemannian description of the hyperbolic metric. And you have a proof that you have to, from this construction, you have the hyperbolic trigonometry formulas, the hyperbolic of Pythagoras theorem. You can all see it rather directly if you take this picture. So, Francis, why is this a geodesic if we know we have a Riemannian metric? So what I can do is, I can take all circles which have the endpoint on the real axis as center, all Euclidean circles. I do the same here. And then, of course, we have some way, we have many circles. But this picture is a picture of a projection. So some random point Z, I can project to this line along those circles. And the linear part, the part of the vector which is parallel to the projection line disappears in projection, and the perpendicular part remains. And now the hyperbolic trigonometry says that this length divided by this length, but all infinitesimal, is the definition of the hyperbolic cosine. So that means it is shrinking. So that means every path which is outside, when I project, I get the path which is shorter. So this means immediately that this path is the shortest path in that Riemannian, for that Riemannian metric. And so those curves which appear at the level of high school, they turn out to be with reasonings which are high school plus, little plus, it becomes geodesics. So it is not an action of solving differential equations. You have the candidate line, like in Euclidean geometry, you do the same. If you wish to prove this, then you take projections parallel. Projections are length shortening, so that means this curve is shorter than any other curve which is in competition. And the same proof works here. But in Euclidean geometry, it is length shortening, and the worst case is factor 1. And here, worst case, the shortening is by cosine hyperbolic something, and cosine hyperbolic is always positive, bigger than 1. So the length shortening is a definite shortening. It's not just that equal lengths can appear. So you have, and many features of hyperbolic geometry appear. Perhaps it's also interesting to see if there is some more geometry here. So in this picture, I said this picture, we vary this A. So naturally, this set as a set is the same as the real numbers. But you could ask, real numbers, of course, they have much more structure than just being a set. There is also a metric. And you could ask, is the metric preserved? The answer is no. And so a metric is a function which has two points, give some number. But we can look, perhaps there are functions which through three points give some number. It's also a structure. Here we have a function on the real line which through 4 points gives some number. And in fact, this set is the affine real line. So what you find naturally back is a quotient construction. So if you have 3 points, then here I have a polynomial which vanishes here. Another point, I have a polynomial and another x minus c. So I have 3 polynomials, and out of those 3 polynomials, I can cook something which is a number, and which the number could be, if I use the ordering, is the division point from A in between C, a fractional point. Here you find the notion of barycenter. I do not expand to this, but it's a formula to give this, to give more structure. The same we can ask here. Do we see more structure? So we have already seen more structure, which was this Riemannian metric, which I did not expand completely. But underlying a Riemannian metric is a conformance structure. So in this set, we have, in a natural way, a conformance structure. It appears for free if you start saying it is upper half plane. Upper half plane is an open set in C, so therefore you have a conformance structure. But here, it appears in a different way. It did not appear directly as open set in C. It appears when I start drawing this as Riemann sphere and make some identifications. So this set comes with the structure. So now we can perhaps...
So, I have a question. So this one, this P and Q where you are doing the linear summation, this I do not understand. So P, x squared plus bx plus c, you are considering a root of P, that, which is in the upper half plane.
Yeah. So yeah. If you think P as a complex number, the polynomial which I think is x minus P times x minus P bar.
So, but no, when you're writing x squared plus bx plus c is positive there, but P, if P is the root, then that would be
zero. P is the root of that polynomial.
Yes.
In upper half plane.
Right. So why is it positive?
This is a positive function on the real line. This I see as a function on the real line. So perhaps it is better I transform this in a function. And for me the letter small x is a coordinate. So this is the function x squared plus bx plus c on the real line.
So you're assuming that this is a positive...
And this is a positive function. Positive
this, this we are assuming, or it is coming out from some...
No, this expression is B and C real numbers. I can say this is a polynomial. But I can also say this expression defines for me a function on the real line. And what this positive means, this function is positive.
Yeah, yeah. I understand that, sir. But what I'm asking is, are you assuming that this function is positive, or is it coming out from something else?
There's a definition. Polynomial did not split. And then this high school with b squared minus 4ac.
Is negative.
With negative means there are no real roots. And then the leading coefficient was x squared. So this expression is always positive.
Because it does not split, then
And this guy on the same reason. And then if you do a convex combination, then t and 1 minus t is positive, so positive remains.
But
if you go away from this, it can go wrong. Go wrong at the first place and the second place, and this also is the minus and so on. So this construction gives many things we know with some interpretation, some other interpretation. So this. Mm-hmm. So the what we discovered here, this sphere with several pieces. So we have C plus, that was the upper part in this sphere. We have C minus, the lower part in this sphere. Then we have R reals, that was part of this circle. And then we have this point at infinity, called infinity point. So we have those. So the transformations from the construction give us transformations in C plus. And that is the usual transformation of PSL2R on C plus. Now I do again bad notation. I write elements in PSL to C by 2 by 2 matrices. And then I must say what happens if I apply to a point P, but this P I think as complex number, and then we get the formula we know is A times P plus B divided by C times P plus D. And now we notice that when I root here plus minus in this expression, the plus minus does not play a role. So the notation by two matrices is allowed if I am interested in this action. The same formula works for the lower piece. So what we get is this piece has symmetries which are controlled by this group. Then this piece has much more symmetries. Much more symmetries. What I do is I take the group of all diffeomorphisms, preserving orientation for later use, of C plus. That is a group of transformations, all diffeomorphisms of C plus, and perhaps the other groups. And the same is true when I take the whole thing. This group acts also on whole thing, on P1, on the Riemann sphere. But the group of diffeomorphisms acts also. So this is the action of PSL2R on, I write P1C, the Riemann sphere. And this is the group of diffeomorphisms of P1C. So if you have a manifold or an open set with a group of diffeomorphisms, you can make manifolds of them. You can say, take local pieces and patch them together, and then insist that in the intersection, the gluings are given by elements in your group. So you can take the group of all orientation preserving diffeomorphisms, or you can take the group of diffeomorphisms which are a very special kind, which you can write as a matrix. So if I take this group, the group of all diffeomorphisms, I get all oriented surfaces. So out of this, I get all oriented surfaces of some genus. Genus can be, and when I make manifolds, we insist that we make only compact manifolds. So genus can be 0, 1, 2, and so on. When I use this group, I get the same surface eventually, but with more structure. And an interesting question is, if I make all surfaces completely free, I can glue by diffeomorphism, can you also make them when I insist that the gluings are done by transformations which are very restricted? also is yes and no. But if gene is two and bigger, also is yes. But we will come back to this. Let's go to uniformization theorem. But there are many other things which are hidden in this picture. So. First, so how much time do I have?
Minutes.
Ah, then something is much more elementary, but also much more useful later on. So perhaps it's good. So classification of surfaces. So we have compact surfaces. And they are oriented. Oriented compact surfaces. So I think we learned that we can draw them genus 0, genus 1, genus 2, and so on. I wish to have a tool for proving this. So which tool do you know to prove this? That the only oriented surfaces of only oriented compact connected. When I say surface, it's automatically without boundary, because surfaces are modeled on something. And here, the upper half plane has no boundary. This line does not belong to the upper half plane. Surface is automatically without boundary. But of course, you are right. We can also talk about surfaces visible. And connected, I put there. Yeah. So what are the tools to prove this? How do you prove that there are no other surfaces? So let's try to make this surface. What you can do is you take a disk, and you take another disk, and then you decide to glue the two boundaries. And your counting is 0, 1, 2, infinity. And everything which is like Banach space is infinity. Okay. So how many possibilities of gluing do you have? So the very optimistic, they say one. And then come those, they say, ah, I have a little, it can turn a little. And then come those, they say, yeah, it turned a little, but the speed of the rotation is not the same all over. So some sectors, they turn fast. So I would say the amount of possibilities here is infinitely many. Possibility. It's a functional space. The space of gluings is a manifold, and this manifold is modeled on a Banach space. And so therefore, it is out of imagination to see all of them. And if I have this guy here, yeah, what I can do is I can break it in two pieces. Then I have a cylinder. Then I have a cylinder. And another cylinder. Is this true? That's a cylinder?
Yeah.
And then I glue like this, a Banach space of possibilities. I glue here, a Banach space of possibilities. So to make torus by cutting in pieces, you have infinitely many possibilities. And here it becomes worse and worse. But the classification goes with very concrete things. You have genus 0, genus 1, genus 2, and so on. What are the main steps to bring you from this weird set of possibilities to something which is very concrete? Here, with 0, you say, ah, if we have two disks which copies of each other with blue bi-identity. When we have two cylinders, then every cylinder has two boundary pieces, but we glue the corresponding pieces by identity. So no freedom. You give the pieces and no freedom. So what is the mathematical tool that says this is the wrong way of doing? So, in mathematics, there is one word which is very important, which simplifies proofs, it's called induction. So, when we have manifolds of dimension 1, and we cut in pieces, and we have intervals, and then the gluings, the finite set gluings, will become combinatorics. So, no Banach at all. So what we want to go back to this one-dimensional thing. I did it already a little. I cut along something, which is circles, and then I do gluings of circles. But the circles themselves I understand very well. But the gluings I do not understand so well. So what is the tool to break a surface in pieces? In general, if you have a manifold, then you can take a function and then the pieces or the levels of this function. So if you do not understand the function, then you gain nothing. But if you understand the function, then you gain something. Understanding a function, so a manifold, this is locally, this is the piece of Rn. This is an open set in Rn. Manifold is. And the function is, on every such open set you have a function. So what do you know about functions? Which functions do you understand completely? I think that in courses, so people tell about functions and they say things which are extremely obvious about functions. But the very important thing is, there is a way of understanding a function locally, and there are only two theorems available to understand functions locally. What are those two theorems? There are two theorems allowing you to understand a function locally, and the only two. And they appear in every university, in every continent, and also here. Inverse, yeah. So a function, if we have here our coordinates, if we have our function, the inverse function says locally every function becomes very simple. How simple does the function become locally? If you are free to choose the coordinates. So implicit function theorem says locally. In good choice of coordinates, there is only one function, that's the function first coordinate. Because the implicit function tells you the function locally can be used as coordinate. And then you extend with the other names. So the first, your function becomes x1 coordinate and the others more complicated names. And then there's another theorem. So this is implicit function theorem. That means if the differential at the point is non-zero, then you have this nice implication that the function locally at that point, near that point, is a coordinate. And there's another theorem of the same type, says something easy happens, and says the function is locally, can be written knowing only very few numbers. So which is this function? That theorem. So, we are at the point where the differential is zero. So, first theorem does not work. But then, happily, we can add something extra. And what we add is that the hashes at the function, which is a map from Rn to its dual, the Hessian is an isomorphism. So when you do this, its partial derivatives means the matrix of second partial derivatives have determinant non-zero. The meaning is this. So if you have this, then this implies something nice. That means the function in good coordinates can be chosen as x1 with bad signs, and so on. Function can be written like this. And there is, now you can say, oh, there are many functions globally defined, which locally can be written like this or like this. So this is not clear at all. If you say that something, you understand something locally, to be sure that this something happens globally, that is a miracle. So there is one theorem telling you, so let's call a function which locally behaves like this or like this, let's call this good. At high school, that means that are just the functions where you have no points like this, which do strange things like this. Here, derivative is zero, second derivative is zero. Nothing applies, so good for high school, becomes good for us also. So is there a theorem say that every function can be approximated by a good function? And what is the technical name for a good function? Morse function. Ah, good function is the same as Morse function. And there is a theorem guaranteeing that every function can be approximated, every C2 function with little differentiability can be approximated by a Morse function. And this is based on this much deeper theorem, which also I think appears in many courses, in all courses. The Sartre theorem. Sartre theorem guarantees the existence of Morse functions. So when I have a Morse function, and you do this for surfaces, then what could happen? Let's say it could happen that when I have my torus, then here the level is like this, and the maximum here. So this is a Morse function on the torus. But there are also other Morse functions on the torus. So I could introduce an extra maximum here. And then here, the level around this is again complicated. So the Morse function gives me a decomposition of a surface in pieces. I cut slightly, so the points where this story applies is point called a critical point. I take on the image line, I take the images of the critical values, and so on. And then I cut at levels in between. Then the whole thing become pieces, if you do this in the surface. And the pieces which we get are of very small type. You can get disks, you can get cylinders, and we can get something called pair of pens. So every surface is glued together by those pieces. So now the problem is the gluings, that was still Banach's story. But we have standard pieces, plus gluings which at first look appear to be of Banach type. But when we think a little more of this Banach problem, we have those pieces. And we wish to get to those numbers. 0, 1, 2. So a way to go from object to number in practical is very easy. You try to buy this thing. You go to a shop and then you hear a number. So let's try to put price. Here I put price A. Here I put the price B. And here I put the price C. And I wish that this pricing has topological meaning. So when I wish to buy two cylinders, I can put them on top of each other. So two cylinders has the same price as one cylinder. Because before paying, you go to the shop, you put them together, and then you go to the kassa. So this gives a little equation, 2b equals b. Ah, this you can even solve, is b equal to 0. Then, this A and C. Ah, you take a cap and a pair of pens, and you put this cap here. And then you deform this, it's a topological pricing. Then it becomes a cylinder. So you say, so here was A, here was C, and the whole thing is B. So we have A plus C is B, and B was 0. Ah, C is minus A. Then we can put price, we can put the price, we can say now we wish to normalize. And we put for A to be 1 rupee, 1. So now every surface gets a price. Somebody knows another name for this price. For every surface, you get the price. You cut it in pieces, you buy the pieces, you do this pricing. Every surface has a price. So what is the price of a sphere? It's allocated. So this is allocated. And then there is something called genus, but we wrote in here genus, but genus and other characteristics are related. 2 minus 2 times the genus is other characteristics. So I stop here.